Tonight at the Internet Cafe, games on the net. Meet game guru George Jones for a guide to great gaming sites. Here's a game with an attitude, full throttle, and its mild-mannered designer, Tim Schafer. The Total Entertainment Network gets a 10 for letting you go online and play other gamers around the world. And MUDs gain a new dimension, cool graphics, thanks to Mike Sellers and Meridian 59. Plus free software, blackjack, Tetris with triangles, home stretch, and virtual pool, all coming your way in our Cyber Blast. Games on the net tonight at the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stuart Chaffee. We're so busy talking here. Jane Wither and Andrew DeVries. And we're talking about games tonight. And I must admit, I'm a gamer. But do you like games? Computer games? Net games?
I like games, but not all games. It's hard for me to relate to.
Well, nobody likes all games.
I can't be a Super Mario, okay? But I like the games where I can
Have you done Nintendo 64 Super Mario?
Yeah, I admit
I haven't. Trust me, that is a great game.
I like the games that are a little more where I can go in and sort of live the character fantasy.
So you like the fantasy adventure role playing kind of thing?
When I was younger, I wanted to be a rock star, okay, more than anything. And there's a lot of games now where I can actually go be a rock star. I can produce music videos and things like that. Or I could be in a biker gang, you know, Full Throttle by LucasArts.
Oh, the true Andrew.
I want to be a biker, right? Exactly.
All right, Jane, you a gamer?
I wouldn't touch them for the world.
Is it because it's a guy thing or
what? No, it's not a guy thing. I just think. I don't know. I have this thought that if I'm going to download a game, it's going to blast my PC and I'll be, you know, trying to reconfigure it all night long.
Well, that happens.
I know. Pico girl.
But, I mean, it happens. It's true. I mean, one of the things that's nice about the Sony PlayStations and the Segas is you buy the thing, it works, and you're done. Where, yeah, you buy a CD-ROM game and you start to configure and you'll never be able to use your computer again after that. It often happens. I do like games, as I told you. I think they're really cool. I love playing those games, and I like games because they push hardware development, they push graphics, they push interfaces. I think games are, like, better for technology. I mean, what does it take to do a spreadsheet, really?
So you're saying that in the future, games may actually be the forefront?
Everybody's talking about the metaphor for the Internet and online shopping, games, because of today's 8-year-olds.
Right? I want to use a joystick to do my word processing.
Yeah, right. All right, we're going to look at games today at the Internet Cafe. Don't go away.
So, George, I know you from San Francisco. I know your guy likes to ride his bike around the city and used to write for Computer Gaming World magazine. But what makes you, like, an expert on games?
I've been playing them forever.
Forever. Forever. How long is forever? How long have computer games been around?
Well, I've been playing them since I was about 10.
10?
Big 20. Commodore 64. I mean, these are
You're right.
Old
it was
games.
Forever.
Oh, man. It was so long ago.
But, and what are you doing now?
Well, I'm senior editor at GameCenter.com, and we're a thorough gaming magazine. We're doing reviews and we're doing strategies and we're doing everything on the web.
So you're like testing games, playing games, constantly
I'm all up in it.
Writing about things. So what is the kind of the hottest games right now?
The hottest one right now is Quake. It rocks.
Seen it? Played
it? Sweet. You can download it for free on the internet.
Free?
Free.
So how do they make money?
Well, they have to, id Software, who's the maker of the game, has it set up so that you play the game, you get hooked on it, and then all of a sudden you want more. So
you have to go out and buy more. So it's a drug. It's like heroin on the internet for gamers.
I don't know if they'd appreciate that, but yeah. I mean, and the people are just as addicted to it, especially the internet stuff.
What does that mean, an internet game?
Well, what it means is that there's a variety of Quake servers out there. And you log into a server, you jam out with 15 other guys or whatever, and some of them you know.
So you download the game,
right?
And then 15 people can get onto this game and play at the same time?
At any time, too.
Really?
You don't even know them.
So are people establishing relationships, or what's going on there?
That's the funny thing. That's what's happening right now. That's probably the most striking thing, is that there's the clans have arisen, or it's just like a group of guys that have gotten together. Maybe they're united by one thing or another, whatever, but they get together and they play Quake. Their sole purpose is just to get on a server and stomp people.
So they're a team that's been together, they know each other's habits, they know things like that, and
yeah, They know how to, they know how to fight together.
And so they fight, they don't fight against each other, they fight together.
They fight together against other people.
Wow. How do they find other groups to go out and play like that? I mean, is it so organized?
Well, someone's running a page. Well, there's a couple of pages, actually, where you can just go in and check out all the different clans.
Wow. See who's out there. A little bit like a gang on the internet there.
I mean, yeah, it kind of is. I mean, yeah. I don't know, you know, that's kind of a
That's not
word,
probably the right metaphor to use. So what are some other really cool games that are out there right now?
Well, one other cool game is Warcraft 2. This is a great game.
Now, it sounds like a kind of like a killer game, sort of like a Quake. Is it in that same kill Twitch game kind of genre?
It's not the same. It's a strategy game. You basically are developing cities and sending units out to kill each other.
Okay. So, but not fighting so much as...
You're not fighting yourself. You're directing units. It's like war, basically. It's a real-time war strategy game.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What else is hot?
Oh, another Go game that I'm playing a lot right now is John Madden 97. It's a football game.
Football,
Yeah. This game is...
If you grew up in the Bay Area, you really got to like John Madden.
Yeah. I mean, you brought the Raiders.
Right.
But, it's a full-out football game. It's action, which is the best thing. No one's done action football well on the PC.
So what does that mean, action football?
That means I can be the quarterback and I can throw the ball, you know, downfield, or I can be Marcus Allen.
So you get to pick who you want to be.
Right, right.
And who do you like to pick? Who's your favorite person?
I'm the Raiders, so I gotta. They're not that good right now. But,
and what position or any position?
A quarterback, man. You got to play quarterback.
Sure.
But you know, the other good thing about this, what's happening with the sports games, is that you can take it to the internet. And this
really?
Is what Microsoft's
doing.
Really?
So just like Quake.
Right. Microsoft's doing that with their basketball game. And they have a 5-on-5 basketball game, full court basketball.
So multiplayers.
Multiplayers.
People could be all across the country, suddenly they're on a basketball team.
Right, that's the plan. It hasn't been implemented perfectly yet, but that's what's going to happen. And this is incredible. I mean, you could be the point guard, you know, I could be Shaquille O'Neal, and we could play on a team together, even if you live in New York City and I live in Los Angeles.
That's great, and I always wanted to be taller, too, so this is like the perfect
I always wanted to be a point guard, so I could do that, and I always wanted to have a jump shot, so that's good, too.
That's great. So there's a lot of sports games that are moving in that same direction?
I sure hope so. I think that people are getting buzz. They know. They know what's happening. I mean, I think sports games is probably one of the best possible applications of current internet gaming.
For the multiplayer.
You can have a baseball team, 9 different guys. It might be boring when you're batting because there's nothing to do, but everyone plays a different position,
right.
And you all have your roles, and maybe you practice together, you know.
Great.
It's pretty sweet.
Sounds like a cool world.
Hey, played Myst? Perhaps you've been frustrated in the library. Don't get even. Get pissed. Starring John Goodman as King Mattress, creator Pete Bergman from Firesign Theater, in this fun-filled CD-ROM adventure. Hey, we got everything. We've got trailer trash. We've got New Jersey shoreline toxic waste. We've got it all. And if you want to send a postcard, go to our website, piss.com, to send a postcard to someone over the internet.
All right, Tim, this is Full Throttle, a game you designed. And first of all, just let's talk about the game. What are you doing, Full Throttle? What kind of game is it?
You play a biker named Ben, and you take on his personality. And it's a graphic adventure where he's on the run for a crime he didn't commit, and the law's chasing him, and a murderer happens, and the real killer is trying to find him, and there's a road trip. So
it's role-playing adventure, that kind of game?
And solving puzzles and...
Okay. Anything unique or different? I mean, what was sort of groundbreaking about what you did with Full Throttle?
We were going for a much more cinematic look, even though it's animated. It's animated and more.
Sort of the interactive movie, only animated.
Yeah, more of it's hard to find a metaphor for it because it's kind of a graphic novel.
It's like,
is it a movie? No, because people experience it different than a movie. They don't sit down for 2 hours. They come home every night, maybe like a book. And
yeah, let's back up a minute. What are the different sort of genres? When you say I'm going to write a game, it can be this kind of game or this kind of game or this kind of game.
Mm-hmm.
What are they?
For all games?
Yeah, I mean, there's...
Well, yeah, I do just graphic adventures, which they're not action-oriented, even though the plot and the story can be action-oriented.
So it's problem-solving kind of stuff?
Yeah, exploratory and puzzle-solving.
Is there... You guys who do games, I mean, is that sort of a weird culture? I mean, you sit up all night long and figure out, how am I gonna screw up these kids next? I mean,
It's kind of strange because it's the kind of, most of the people who work there are the kind of people who were doing that for fun, like at college.
Not getting paid for it.
And not getting paid for it. Now they're getting paid for it. And and you know, computer programmers are different kind of, they're differently socialized than.
But I mean, are the game programmers different from everybody else?
Game programmers are often just fanatical gamers.
Yeah.
You know, and they'll work all day and then they'll stay at the office to play games all night and.
Is it competitive? I mean, you sit down and say, I'm going to do something nobody's ever done before, or somehow get some juice or some power coming out of this game that nobody's figured out how to do before?
Yeah, well, it's there's a drive to do something no one's seen before, you know, a new, you know, genre. We were trying to do a biker game just because the games have been done before. It was either, you know, it's always science fiction or fantasy,
right,
medieval,
right.
And just no one had really touched, you know, The Wild One or Easy Rider or and computers and Harleys, they go together more than, you know, people would think.
But I mean, apart from stories, in terms of like really pushing the envelope, when you're working on a new game right now, I mean, what is it you're trying to do? I mean, better graphics, better sound, better interface. What's the sort of holy grail of gamers?
Well, all of that, I mean, it starts off with like one of the first adventure games like Zork, where there's it's all treasure hunting and you don't have a character, but each game that's gone by has had more story elements and more character depth. And the last game that we had done, Day of the Tentacle, that I had worked on, it had a basic plot that kind of shows up in the beginning and shows up periodically and then mm-hmm. comes up in the end. But every game we try to do more and more just a real story, a complicated story with a real human involvement, and the new game I'm working on now, I try to do a story with just many more characters, and that spans a long period of time for mm-hmm. the characters' lives.
Well, I mean, what makes a game a success? I mean, Myst was a big hit, but yet that was sort of a weird game in a way, really.
What makes a game?
I mean, you have a sense of what the guys want to do, play these things.
Yeah, we were the theory of Full Throttle was that people had played games where they played sort of a meek character, like
okay, and here you're a macho guy.
We're like, well, most people who use computers, maybe they would actually like to have. It is kind of a fantasy
kick some
environment.
Butt.
Yeah, do something they can't do in real life. Ride a motorcycle off a cliff, jump a flaming. You know, bus, you know, just.
All right, well, I'm gonna try to do this now, so you're gonna help me. I got the guy here, right? So you can figure out how to do this.
Chris, as the editorial director of 10 and File Factory, I know that you know a lot about online gaming, and I've gotta tell you, all night, I've been given a hard time because I don't play the game, so I don't play, you know, Doom or anything like that. So I'm hoping that you can fill me in on all of the little jargon so that at the end of the night I can say, I know what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So a couple of questions. First of all, File Factory. Seems kind of interesting to me in that you can upload and download games. So what kind of games and how does that all work?
Right. Well, basically we try to cover it all. We give you demos of retail games, shareware games, freeware games. Got a section called Homebrew where we collect together all the different add-on programs and user-created maps that people create for games.
Oh, really? So they take an existing game and start making additions
mm-hmm.
to it?
Yes.
So it actually starts to evolve and change?
Right. Like
oh,
some games like Duke Nukem, they provided an editor with the game. So you can actually go in and create 3D worlds for other people to play.
Is that freeware or is that shareware?
Yeah, that's freeware.
Okay, now what's freeware? I think I know what that is. What's shareware? What's mm-hmm. the difference?
Well, freeware, basically, you're saying, I've created this, take it, and have fun. With shareware, you're asking people to register the game, to give you some money, $15-$20, if you use the game and enjoy it.
Do they often get the money that they ask for?
Unfortunately, no. With a lot of games, not many people register.
So we gotta work on that, because mm-hmm. it sounds like it's a lot of fun to start. I mean, these people really like what they're doing,
mm-hmm.
making additions to all these new games.
These people put a lot of effort into these games.
Sounds like it.
Yeah.
Now, another one is online gaming, so it's actually interactive gaming with other people, and I have absolutely no idea how one would start doing something like that. I mean, what's the process on getting into some game like that?
Right. Well, over the past year, a couple companies have come along and said, you know, we're going to try to create an environment for online gaming over the internet. One company, 10, which I work for, does this. Basically, we bring together people from all over the continent to play games over the internet.
Okay, so, and so they're playing them simultaneously, is that right?
Mm-hmm. They're playing together.
Okay, yeah. So my impression with that is that, you know, you hear a lot of talk about the net and how slow it is at certain times of the day, and if you're playing an interactive game with somebody on the other side of the country, mm-hmm. one would assume that it's pretty slow.
Yeah, that's called latency.
Okay.
Basically, that's the time it takes from a signal to go from your computer through the internet and to the other person's computer.
So is it slow with the system, or is there anything you can do to make it
It can be.
Perform better?
Yeah, at TIM what we try to do is we optimize the network. We lay high bandwidth lines from our service to major internet hubs, which creates a quicker pathway for data. So we can get latencies down to a quarter of a second.
So what kind of games would I want to play?
Well, we've got quite a few. We've got fast action games like Duke Nukem and Quake, and these are the games for which latency really matters.
Okay.
Requires instantaneous response. We've got role-playing games like Dark Sun, where hundreds of people can get together into this fantasy world and muck around. And we've got strategy games like Warcraft, Panzer General.
So these games, do they go on for a long time? Is it like Dungeons and Dragons and people
kind
of play for a long time and get right into that?
Yeah, a game like Dark Sun is what we call a persistent environment. The world never goes away. People just pop into it and pop out. Then there are games like Duke Nukem where it's a session-by-session thing. You know, you hop in, you play for 15 minutes or to a certain number of kills, and then you drop out.
I think I've got to try this. This sounds really actually pretty interesting.
You should.
Thanks a lot, Chris.
No problem.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you four great games, a little over 4 megabytes of data during the next 120 seconds. What you're seeing over here is the actual computer data in the TV signal going into your computer. To get the data through the TV signal, you need a TV modem, or you can download the files from our website using your regular modem. Download time at 28.8 will be almost 30 minutes. Let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, a great blackjack game called Casino Verite Blackjack. This game won the Ziff Davis Shareware Award for Best Casino Card Game of the Year. It has actual casino rules from over 500 different gaming places, so you can customize the game to your taste. Next, if you're a Tetris fan, you'll love this game called Diagle. Multicolored triangles fall down, and you have to rotate the triangles and get them to form a pyramid at the bottom of the screen. And in this game, the triangles bounce off the walls. It's a challenge. Also, Home Stretch. This is a thoroughbred horse race simulation game. It includes complete wagering simulations with the ability to bet on win, place, show, exactas, and quinellas. This has been called the most realistic racetrack simulation program. Finally, a great game called Virtual Pool from Interplay. This pool game accurately captures all the geometry and physics of a real billiards game. It uses revolutionary new video acceleration, which gives you a true lifelike gaming experience. If you need information on how to use or find a TV modem so you can do the fast download of these games, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at www.pctv.com. You can also find information on how to download the same files through your regular modem from our website. So the download is just about complete. Have fun with your four new games. That wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Laurie Anderson.
All right, Mike, we're going to talk about MUDs, which is a sort of special form of gameplay that takes place on the net. And for people who don't know what a MUD is, I mean, what's the history of MUDs? First of all, what's MUD stand for? It's an acronym.
Okay, yeah, multi-user dimension, originally multi-user dungeon.
Yeah.
Right, but most people have to say multi-user dimension or domain. It has less of a dungeon ring. They started back in the early 80s after games like Adventure and Colossal Cave and things like that, which are all single-player games, but all fantasy role-playing games based on the old Dungeons & Dragons tradition. So back in the mid-80s or so, people started putting together games you could have multiple people online at the same time on the then new internet,
right.
All in text, all running around the same world together. So you'd see a text description of a room that says you're in a dark cave and somebody else is standing there. And then you could talk to them or fight them or do things like that. But again, it was all text. So these have been going on now since then. And in fact, I started playing MUDs four years ago now. I don't know how long time ago now.
But you MUDder guys, I mean, are serious, right? I mean,
very
these guys
serious,
are up all night taking this like, this is a life.
People play this around the world. In fact, some of the best MUDs are based in Sweden. Some of them based in Berkeley. People take this very seriously.
All right. Now, the problem with MUDs online is they were text-driven because that's about all you could do.
Right.
And to some degree, a little bit boring. I mean, unless you really got into the story stuff. And your idea was, why not turn these into graphical things?
Exactly right.
But how do you squeeze all that stuff down the internet?
Well, you can't. Right. At least not with today's bandwidth and computers, you just can't do it. So the idea we had, which now seems blindingly obvious, is to put them on a CD-ROM and to have the only thing that comes across the internet is the instructions of how to put a scene together. Put a tree here, put a brick there, assemble a person out of parts and put them on there, and then that becomes what people see. So we actually provide a first-person 3D view of this world that we've created.
Okay, so let's go straight. We now is Meridian 59,
right,
which is really this mud you've created.
Right.
And in this one, all the action is taking place online, but all the graphics, so it's really cool and visual, is taking place off a CD-ROM.
Exactly right. So we have several hundred people at any given time who are in this world together. They can talk just like we're talking now,
yeah.
But it's all across the internet. So you could be talking to someone from Idaho and someone else from, you know, Ireland.
Okay, but what's the game? I mean, what's going on
okay,
in there?
Okay, well, it's a fantasy role-playing world, but it's not a plot-driven game where you have to accomplish something and then the game ends. The game never ends. It's a persistent world that's going
on. It's alive.
It's going on as we speak. Right, so it's going on all the time. It's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
So I can log on right now, and I'm in the Meridian world.
In the world, exactly.
With thousands of other people.
Hundreds of other people at a time, right.
Well, what are we trying to accomplish?
Well, everyone's trying to do what they want to do with their character. You can become the best fighter or the best magic user or just even know the most about the world or about the political situation that's going on in the world. There's all different kinds of things people can do. We've tried to provide a real breadth of activity. And then for all the different kinds of things you can do, more and more complexity of activity to keep people coming back for more.
Right. Now, you really have addicts in a way who do this, right? Who play for hours
right.
and hours. Now, you tell me, this one guy played how long?
We've had people who played over 28 hours at a stretch.
Non-stop.
Non-stop. And we have many people who play more than 40 hours a week. Many, many people who play more than 40 hours a week.
Now, what's really interesting on these muds, and yours in particular, is we tend to think of these people, they don't have a life, right? So they just live in the mud. And to some degree, literally, I mean, you told me there are people who really don't have a life, and this is their social
exactly.
existence.
Exactly. At one end of the spectrum, we have people who, you know, like you and me, they go to work every day, they come home, they play a couple hours, that's what they do. We have other people that are very far in the spectrum who are terminally ill. There's a few people we know of who are terminally ill, and they have no way to get out and actually have a social life.
They really
life.
Cannot physically get out
right.
and do anything.
Right, so they are no longer shut-ins because they now have really true, deep friendships with people online. There's real emotional interaction and content there. We also have a lot of people, like we have a number of women in their early 40s who are lawyers or other professionals who lead a very buttoned-down existence during the day, don't want to go out to a bar or something like that. So they come online and they have a good time. And again, they meet people, they get married to people, they have
vendettas. I mean, really? Not just in the game? Or?
Well, we've had a couple marriages, and we've got one impending one, but they're also marriages
so
in the game
as well.
So it's
this weird combination of, like, chat room, but there's a whole world really
right,
going
exactly,
on around
exactly.
it.
It's not just a chat room. There is a whole world going on. There are things to do. There's monsters to kill, and there's a princess and a duke, and you decide if you want to serve one or the other. There's guilds that you can align yourself with and become a member of. There's all different kinds of things to do in the world. By making the world a little bit dangerous and a lot more deeply textured, we find that we get a lot more social interaction.
All right,
out of
I got it up here, so I'm going to start trying to log on to this thing right now here, Mike.
Okay, Andrew. Now, for those of us like myself who don't spend a lot of time playing games, unlike other people like yourself who
I
do.
I like games.
Well, what we can do is maybe go to Yahoo and show folks how we can try to find more information about computer games.
Okay.
So here we are. Why don't we type in?
I'm going to type in computer games
okay.
and see what comes up.
That was fast. Let's
yes.
have a look down
oh,
here.
Oh, there's a lot.
How many do we have?
Looks like about 524 matches here.
Okay. Recreation?
Recreation computer games. There's a whole listing here of all different kinds of information. You've got a section on cheats and hints, which is something that if you want sort of the latest how-to on certain types of games, you can just go click on that
Somebody
site.
Click?
Yeah,
okay.
go ahead. And you've got things like 3D game cheats and wads. And here's a guy who's written all kinds of files about Doom 1 and 2 and Heretic and Duke Nukem. And you can know all the latest tricks. So that's kind of what a...
So there's all these cheat pages,
exactly.
how to get around it. Boy,
yeah.
people must spend a lot of time doing
cheating.
This kind of stuff.
Why don't you go back
cheating.
To that main page there.
Right. What else do we have?
One of the other nice things is we talked today with a guy from the game... game.com.
Mm-hmm.
He does all kinds of reviews, and there's a whole section of reviews. There's 364 different pages listed here of reviews of some of the really most, you know, kind of popular games here.
So before you buy it, you can get all the information
yeah,
that you need.
Yeah, here we're going to the Bathouse reviews. And you can even choose here between action or adventure games. Actually, what's the difference, action or adventure?
They're all kind of the same, aren't they?
Yeah. So here, let's go to action and see what we've got there. And you see, you've got reviews
Doom.
of Doom, Duke Nukem,
Nukem, Hexen.
Heroes. And this is nice because, you know, these games are expensive. I mean, some of them cost up to $50.
Yeah, so you really do want to check it out before you buy
right,
it.
Right, exactly.
So let's see, what else do we have?
So you can see there's really a lot that...
Now multiplayer. Let's have a look at that, because that's the thing that kind of interests me. Avatar, you name it, GameNet, Gamers Page, it's all there. Boy, we could pretty much do it all.
You're right.
We could spend hours just on Yahoo getting information about games.
Definitely. There's a lot, so it's a good, especially for people who maybe don't know a lot.
Andrew, is this Jane, the one who said she didn't like playing computer games?
Jane, come back.
Jane, come on.
Well, hi.
All right, you don't like computer games?
They're okay.
Come on.
You
how
look
is
like
that?
You were hooked.
It's kind of fun.
Come on. How is it?
It's really good. This thing is really cool.
What are you
cool.
doing? Tell us what you were doing.
Well, this is virtual reality, and basically I had this little puppy on my head. And I'm looking through, and I'm walking through different corridors and stuff, and I've got all these aliens coming at me, and so I'm moving forward, and I'm getting them and going down sewers and up ceiling.
And you navigate by just using your
and
body,
not a joystick.
And
I move my body around, exactly. So as I move, I redirect my my angle. It's,
wow.
it's pretty
so
cool.
So you may not like computer games or online games, but you like VR games, huh?
Well, my heart's pumping, and it's not the caffeine.
All right, Andrew, let's talk about these guys over here. Now, you've played some of those
right.
games. What are they?
Well, speaking about getting your heart pumping, you get to go skiing and you get to go snowboarding, and it's about as real as you can get without actually going onto the slopes. I heard you actually had a little experience with snowboarding.
A real snowboarding broke my leg, so I'm going to stick with those things.
Okay, great.
All right, so there are all kinds of computer games to play, not just the stuff we were looking at there. So you can go back in your helmet, go back into your virtual world. Andrew, let's go skiing.
All right.
We'll see you next week at the Internet Cafe.
I'm getting pretty good at this.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.